Bow our heads for prayer. Father, we ask your blessings upon this time together as we take a look at your word. This is a message particularly for fathers, but God, really, it applies to each and every one of us. As dads, one of the things I so appreciated about the song that the choir sang, Lord, was the fact that the song said that we need godly dads. We don't just need good dads, but we need godly dads. We need dads who are willing to stand against sin. We need dads who are willing to take a stand for what's right. We need dads who are able to lead their family and lead them into truth and lead them to do right. We pray, Father, that you would bless this message on all hearts, but particularly on the hearts of the dads this morning, for it's in Jesus' name that we pray. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. Name of the message tonight are some things, or this morning, is to things to remember. The first three things we're going to look at are things that we need to remember about God, and then we're going to look at three things that we ought to remember about ourselves. But in this passage, if you look down in verse 17, it says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. God is called our Father, our Heavenly Father. A person does not have God as his or her Father until they come to the point where they realize that they're a sinner, that they deserve to die and go to hell for all eternity. And they repent of their sin, they believe on Christ and Christ alone, realizing that good works can't get you to heaven. There's not anything that you can do to get there. That's why Jesus had to leave heaven, had to come down here, take on human form, and bear the sins of the entire world and be the sacrifice for our sin. When a person believes on that and trusts Christ as their Savior, that's not only when they get eternal life, not only when they become born again, but it's also the time when God becomes their Father. Prior to that, the Bible says, ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of the father you will do. But when a person trusts Christ as Savior, the Lord becomes our Father. There's some things that we need to remember about God. And the first thing that we need to remember is that God is a God of judgment, that God hates sin. Sin is never your friend. Sin always complicates things, and sin ends in death. It started with Adam and Eve. There was no death in the Garden of Eden, but once Adam and Eve sinned, then they were expelled from the garden, and the Bible said by one man, sin entered the world and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men for that all have sinned. If you look with me in verse 13, it says, let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. James chapter 1 deals with temptation, and he makes it very, very clear that God never tempts someone to sin. Now, some people say, well, then there's a contradiction in the Bible, because over in Genesis chapter 22, it says specifically that God tempted Abraham. He did tempt Abraham. He tempted him to obey, not to disobey. He tempted him to do right. And that temptation can also be called a testing. He was testing him. And that's the form of the temptation. But God doesn't tempt us to sin. It's a process that goes on the inside of us. If you look down in verse 14, it says, but every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Do not err, my beloved brethren. The process that God lines out for us is, he says that it starts with lust. It starts with the wrong desires, wanting the wrong things. And that involves our emotions. Then the second step is enticement. And that involves oftentimes deceptive alluring. It's kind of like bait in a mouse trap. You know, you put the bait in the trap, and when the mouse comes along, he sees the bait clearly. But what he doesn't see is that thing coming over once he trips it. He doesn't see that thing coming over, hitting him in the neck, and taking his life. And that's what sin is like. Sin looks pleasurable, looks good on the surface. But what we don't see is we don't see the dangers that are entailed therein. And that enticement involves our intellect. Then the next step is, the third step is the sin itself. In verse 15, it says, then lust hath conceived, when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Sin is just simply an act of disobedience against God. And we avoid sin when we'll do what's right rather than act upon what we feel or act even upon what we think. We act upon what we know is right. And then, the last step is death. Where sin started was when by one man sin entered the world, death by sin. So then death passed upon all men for that all have sinned. And all of us are going to have to one day face death because of sin. The reason why that is that God judges sin. God is a God of judgment. And the Bible tells us, be not deceived, God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. It's not just because of the sin itself, but it's also because there is a God who hates sin, who hates disobedience, and who acts upon that disobedience. God is consistent when it comes to judgment. And the Bible says, he whom he loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. One of the traits that a father needs to have is a trait that the Father of lights has. And that is that dads need to be men of judgment. Now, we don't like that. I hope you don't like that. You know, one of the things that I absolutely hated to do when we were raising our five children was having to discipline our kids. That was, you know, the old saying, you know, this hurts me more than it hurts you. This is harder on me than it is on you. No kid ever believes that, okay? No kid ever does. But if you've been a dad, you do understand that. And that's not a fun time. It's just not a fun time. As a matter of fact, and this probably isn't a good attitude to have, but I walk past fathers from time to time in this church. They're struggling with their kids and says, okay, go to this room or go to that room or we're going to have a talk when you get home. And I look at that and say, man, am I glad that stage is done. I'm glad that stage is over. But God is a God of judgment. And so because of that, dads need to be consistent in their judgment and be willing to do it. Be willing to do it. Again, it's not an easy thing to do. The Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. I believe the beginning of a proper and a right relationship with the Father is the fear of the Father. I think about it when I was young, my mom and dad they were very much jokesters. My mom died when I was 8 years old, so I don't remember a lot. But I do remember one time being in the bedroom with them, and I don't remember who initiated it first. I'm suspicious it was my mother, because she knew what the answer would be, because I was young at the time. And she said, well, who do you love the most? Do you love mom or do you love dad? Well, I'm looking at that thing saying, well, let's see, what does dad do? Well, dad does take care of me, but dad's the one who usually gives the discipline. And mom's the one who gives me hugs. Mom's the one who gives me kisses. Mom's the one who puts the food on the table. Oh, that's easy. That's hands down. I love mom more than I love dad. And I remember saying that. Why is, you say, well, that's not healthy. Yes, it is healthy. Because as I got older and as I lost my mom, man, I realized just how much my dad loved me and that my dad hated to have to do the discipline thing, but was willing to do the discipline thing when it was necessary. So the first thing you remember about God is that God is a God of judgment. And as fathers, we need to be consistent. We need to be constant when it comes to judgment. Consistency, I think, is just consistency, period, in every area, is one of the greatest attributes that a father can have, just being consistent. And then the second thing that we see is God's goodness. Look down in verse 17. It says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. The Bible says that every good gift and every perfect gift cometh down from above from the Father of lights. That's because God is good. We sin when we doubt the goodness of God. You think about this. When Eve was in the garden and she was tempted by Satan to take of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and she was told that she could eat of every tree in the garden except for that one. And basically what Satan said was, well, you know why he told you couldn't eat this one? Because the day you eat thereof, you'll be enlightened and you'll know what he knows, and he doesn't want you to do that. What he got her to do was to doubt the goodness of God. And when you start to doubt the goodness of God, that's when you start slipping and falling. Keep your finger here in James 1 and go back in your Old Testament to the book of Deuteronomy. Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 6. And God warned about this before they went into the promised land, before Israel went in. He gave them a warning. And his warning is found in verses 10 through 15. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 10 through 15. Verse 10 says, and it shall be when the Lord thy God shall have brought thee into the land which he sware unto thy fathers, to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob, and to give thee great and goodly cities, which thou buildest not, and houses full of all good things, which thou fillest not, and wells digged, which thou diggest not, vineyards and olive trees, which thou plantest not, when thou shalt have eaten and be full, then beware, lest thou forget the Lord, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. Thou shalt fear the Lord thy God and serve him, and shalt swear by his name. Ye shall not go after other gods of the gods of the people which are round about you, for the Lord thy God is a jealous God among you, lest the anger of the Lord thy God be kindled against thee and destroy thee from off the face of the earth. God was good to Israel, but when they forgot forgot his goodness, that's when they slipped and that's when they fell. When God gives gifts, he only gives good gifts, according to verse 17. Every good gift and every perfect gift cometh down from above from the Father of lights. When the Apostle Paul, after he saw a little vision of heaven, and God gave him a little extra knowledge that others didn't have, God also knew that Paul had a tendency to be a little bit puffed up and proudful, and so he gave him a thorn in the flesh. It was something that bothered him. It was something that evidently was painful. We're not told exactly what that thorn was. Some say it was a physical problem. Others say that it was an individual. Others say it might have been some circumstance in his life. Who knows? He doesn't identify it. I believe that's on purpose so that we could identify with it and not just hone it down to one specific thing. But he says he gave him a thorn in the flesh. And he gave it to him in order to keep him from pride. Now, again, it was a painful thing. That's why he calls it a thorn. However, it was a gift. It was a blessing. When God gave it to him, allowed him to have it, he gave it to him to spare him some grief, to spare him some trouble. So, and then on top of it, he told him, he said, "My grace is sufficient for thee. My strength is made perfect in weakness." Now, God only gives good gifts. And the other thing that's a blessing is that God doesn't change. In verse 17, the last part of the verse, he says, "With whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning." God doesn't change. And even though, like back in the Old Testament, Joseph knew that one day, because of a vision that he got, that one day his father and his father and his brothers would be paying obeisance to him and giving him honor one day. And but before that happened, he ended up at, his brothers put him in a pit. He got sold into Egypt. Then he got wrongfully accused of doing something he didn't do. He was wrongfully thrown in jail. When he was in jail, he was able to interpret a dream for two men. And one of the men said, "Well, I'll remember you to Pharaoh when I get out." He got out. He forgot about him. And he just had disappointment after disappointment after disappointment. What he did not know at the time was that God was preparing him. And again, those things were gifts, and God was consistent. He had his hand upon Joseph. Realizing that even when the temptations come, even when the trials come, even when the difficulties come, during those times, nothing changes about God. God is still good. I love it when... whenever someone says, how you doing? I say, "Well, I know this, God is good." And the other individual says, "All the time, all the time." Whenever someone says that, I know they've been through some stuff. I know that all has not been peaches and roses, okay? All has not been wonderful, but, they understood. They understand. That's why they say all the time that even through those tough times, God's goodness is there. You look at in the Old Testament, David. He was anointed in his home. He was a young man at the time. I believe he's probably in his teen years, and he was out in the sheepfold. His father called him in, and the prophet Samuel anointed him. And the purpose of that anointing was to let him know that one day he would become king of Israel. And yet, from that time on, he had an awful lot of turmoil in his life. You know, this idea that, you know, when I trust Christ as Savior, when I get saved, everything will turn to roses, everything will be wonderful. All my problems will be rolled away. There's some songs that imply that kind of thing. Those songs are deceitful because, honestly, sometimes you'll end up with more problems, not less problems. But God is still good through all of that trial. God is still good through all of those difficulties. And while he was running from Saul in the wilderness, because Saul got jealous and tried to kill him, the Lord stayed consistent. And God is constant in his goodness. That means he's good all the time. The Bible tells us over in the book of Psalms, speaking of God, it says, "Who daily loadeth us with benefits. I love that verse. That is becoming one of my favorite verses in Scripture. Because that's true whether you recognize it or not. That's true whether I recognize it or not. And the reason why that's true is because God's goodness is constant. His goodness is constant. And then the third thing we got to remember about God is not only of his judgment, which is consistent, and his goodness, which is constant, but we need to remember his nature, just his overall nature, who he is. Looking again in verse 17, the last part of the verse, he's called the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. That means he's not one way one day and another way the next. His character and his nature are continual, and he never, ever changes. I am so thankful that I serve a God who absolutely never will lie to me. That's a big deal. Just recently, in fact, yesterday, my wife and I had the opportunity to go to a, they call it a celebration of life in lieu of a funeral service, and it was my mechanic. I had Jeff Surratt as my mechanic for, I don't know, probably 20 years plus. And not only did I have him for a mechanic, but my children used him often as a mechanic for their vehicles. You know, one of the reasons why I chose Jeff is because Jeff was honest with me. You don't see that very much today. I value honesty. I value consistency. And not trying to compare a man with God at all, but God absolutely never will lie to you. God's character will always stay the same. He'll never vary. He says it, in him is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. He's loving all the time. And that never changes. He's kind. He'll never be unkind. He's patient. He's merciful. He's righteous. He'll never be unrighteous. He's true. He's always true. And you can depend on that. You can depend upon the fact that God's nature will never change. And because he doesn't ever change, you can trust him. As a father, we need to be known for our goodness, just like God the Father is known for his goodness. As a father, we need to be known for being constant in our character and continual in our character. The scripture says about God, it says, "For I am the Lord, I change not." I change not. I'm glad I've got a God that isn't like the politicians. Amen. Doesn't promise one thing and then do something else later on down the road. That's not our God. If our God says he's going to do something, he will do it. Pastor Keck on Sunday morning preached on Romans chapter 10 and verse 13. That thrilled my heart because that was the verse that I clung to trust Jesus Christ as Savior. The Bible says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Now, it's not just crying out and using God's name, but it's coming to God and believing in your heart that you are a sinner, believing in your heart that if you get what you deserve, you're going to die and go to hell for all eternity. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And God offers that gift to all that believe on him, who do not trust in their own works, or do not trust in anything that they could do that's right, but simply put all of their trust in what he has done for us on the cross, his death, his burial, and then his resurrection. And then the Bible tells us how to obtain it. "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be save. You know what that means? That means every time someone does that, because they have believed those things that we have previously stated, every single time he gives them eternal life. Every time. And you only need to do it once. All you need to do is to simply ask him to save you and believe on him, believe in your heart, and state it with your mouth and pray and ask for God to save you, calling upon the name of the Lord. And it's, the Bible says that thou shalt be saved. It's a promise. So three things that dads need to be like what God is. God is a God of judgment. Dads, we need to be dads of judgment and stay by your word. Be consistent. And then just as God is good, God is merciful, God is loving. You need to be that way. They need to see that in you. One Father's Day, I preached a message on the mercy of God and how that God is known for mercy. You go to the book of Psalms, and of course, David, in there he confesses sin. In there he cries out to God because he's in trouble. But the thing that I see, particularly through the book of Psalms, over and over and over again, is his mercy endureth forever. He's known for his mercy. And just as God's known for his mercy and his goodness, we as dads need to be known for that as well. And then last of all, his nature, his character, his virtue, not fickle. And as dads, we need to be continual in having the right kind of character. Just like what the choir sang this morning, they said, we need godly men. We need godly men, not just good men. Good men are fine, godly men are better. And godly men are consistent in character. Now, there's three things that we need to remember about ourselves. And those things are found in verses 19 down through 27. Read with me, if you would, back to James chapter 1. Look with me in verses 19 through 21. It says, wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. Number one, remember that we are easily angered. That's particularly true of dads. We need to be reminded of that often. There's some needs that we have, and this passage tells us the four needs. We need to be, first of all, swift to hear. We need to be swift to listen, not swift to fly off the handle, but swift to listen. Secondly, slow to speak in verse 20. Reserve your comments until you've gotten all the information. Reserve what you might, and I've seen this in myself, where I've been swift to speak rather than swift to hear. And then as I'm doing that, I'm actually working myself up into a bit of a frenzy myself. And then the third thing is slow to wrath. Well, you're not going to be slow to wrath if you're slow to hear and swift to speak. You'll be quick to be angry. But the Bible says we ought to be slow to wrath. Why? Because we have a tendency to be quick to wrath, quick to be angry. And then the way that all of that comes to pass is if we have a prepared heart. Look down in verse 21. He says, wherefore, because that's true, because we do have that tendency to be angry very quickly, wherefore lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. He talks about three things there. He says, first of all, he says, be clean. You know, turn your back on the stuff that's filthy, on the stuff that's hurting you, on the stuff that can get you angry, the things that can cause you to sin. And then secondly, be meek. Meekness again, is not weakness at all. Meekness is strength under control. And what meekness is just giving our rights to God and being willing to give up our rights for others. And then it says, receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your soul. If you have a meek spirit about you, you'll learn more from this book than if you have a proud spirit, or you have a haughty spirit, or you have a stubborn spirit. And so the first thing we need to understand is that we're easily angered, we're easily provoked. Then secondly, understand that we easily deceive others by our behavior. Chapter 1, verses 22 down through 25 says, "But be ye doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word, not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself, and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh unto the perfect law of liberty, and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed." We have a tendency to put on airs and to exhibit to others something that really isn't true on the inside. Three things that we do. We behold ourselves, according to verse 24, we behold ourselves, we go our way, and then we forget what we saw, and we don't take care of the matter that's at hand. We've got to continue in the Word. And if we don't continue in the Word, we'll be saying one thing outwardly, but we will be something else on the inside. You know, it's not first and foremost what people see in us. It's what is actually there in us. And if we foster the wrong attitudes, if we become hypocritical, we say one thing and we do another, then we're deceiving others. And one of the things that I've noticed, and I've seen this in my own family, I've seen this in other families, but I've really seen it in my own family, you can't fool your kids. You can't fool your kids. Honestly, you can't fool your wife either. Sometimes you think you can, but you're really not fooling anybody. We deceive others by hearing and not doing. We hear, we know what's right, but then we don't act upon it. And we need to do that. Our family especially will see through our hypocrisy. And then the last thing that we need to remember about ourselves is that we easily deceive ourselves. And that's found in verses 26 and 27. It says, "If any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world." Three things according to that passage that we need to do. We need to speak right, we need to serve others, and we need to stay separated from the world. If we do those things, we'll not easily deceive ourselves. And again, it has to do with hearing and not doing. Knowing that we need to do something, but refusing to do it. And these three things are things we need to remember. We're easily angered. We easily deceive others, and we easily deceive ourselves. That's why it is so important for us to remember those things about God. The fact that God is a God of judgment, that God is good, and that His nature never changes. We need to be, as fathers, like God. We need to remember that we're easily angered. We easily deceive others. We know what we're supposed to do, but we don't do it. And when that is the case, we lose power in our lives. We lose influence in our lives. One of the reasons why Over the years, I've been saved since 1969. I say this, and I'm sure sometimes people think it's just rhetoric. It's not rhetoric. It's the truth. God has never failed me. God has been consistent with me. He's been consistent in judgment. He's been consistent in goodness. He's been consistent in his nature. And because of that, I've learned, and I'm still learning, to trust him and to trust him implicitly. Dads, we need to be godlike. You know, again, that's what the choir was singing about, being godly men. Now, the truth of the matter is we also need godly women and we need godly young people. So this really applies to all. But particularly on this Father's Day, let me encourage you to look to the Father of lights and realize that what you need is to be like he is, to be consistent in judgment, to be constant in goodness, and to constantly have a consistent nature that people can look at you and can trust you and can see the Lord Jesus Christ in you. Let's do this. Let's have every head bowed and let's have every eye closed. Heads bowed and eyes closed. I just want to simply ask a question, and I like to do this often. I don't do this every service, but I like to do it often because I believe it's necessary for us to confront who and what we are. I'd like to ask you this. If you were to die today with your head bowed and your eyes closed and just you and God, being alone together, are you absolutely positive that if you were to die today that you go to heaven? Can you say where you sit, my sins, past, present, and future, even the ones I haven't committed yet, are all forgiven because I've trusted Jesus Christ as my Savior? I realized I was a sinner. There came a point in my life when I realized I was heading for hell. And the only way that I could go to heaven was by putting all my faith and all my trust in Jesus Christ and him alone for the forgiveness of my sins. And I cried out to him and claimed that promise, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you know that for sure, I wonder if you'd just stick your hand in the air as a testimony. Heads bowed and eyes closed. All right, thank you. You can put your hands down. How many of you would be just as honest? Say, you know what? I don't know that for sure. You may even believe all the things that I said, but you've never really come to that point where you've cried out to God and you've asked him to be your Savior. And you've trusted him and him exclusively, not your works, not the things you've done, not anything to do with you, and everything to do with his death, his burial, and his resurrection. If you're in that situation right now, and you would appreciate prayer, I'd count it a real honor to be able to pray for you. I wouldn't call you by name. I wouldn't point you out. I'll just simply recognize that your hand is in the air. But if you'd like me to pray for you, just raise your hand. Just say, Pastor, here's my hand. I don't know that for sure. I don't have that assurance that you're talking about. Man, I'd sure like to have it. Would you please pray for me? Anyone like that here this morning? You're here particularly as a dad. And maybe God tapped on your heart's door about some inconsistencies in your life. This morning is a good morning to begin to take care of those things. Father, we pray that you would have your will and your way in this invitation. I pray for anyone that might be here this morning that does not know for sure that if they died today, they go to heaven. Lord, in no way do we ever look our nose down upon people like that, because the truth of the matter is every single one of us was in that same condition at one point of our life. And we realized that we were a sinner on our way to hell. We cried out to you for mercy, and you saved our soul. And God, we desire that for every single person that we meet more than anything in the world. Lord, I pray that you'd work on their hearts if those folks are here this morning. And God, help them to see how important it is for them to cry out to you and believe on you and to receive eternal life. God, we pray for particularly for our dads this morning. That this morning might be a time of decision for fathers. We might see our own inconsistencies and places where we need to shore up the foundation and be more like you. Father, we pray that you'd have your will and your way in this, your invitation. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.